Hi, welcome to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the film series with lively discussion. I'm your host, Jerry Carlson, and I teach cinema studies at the College of Staten Island of the City University of New York. Today we continue our 10-part series, A Survey of Latin American Film of the Last 25 Years. In fact, today we have our second Brazilian feature film, How Tasty Was My Little Frenchman? Quite an interesting comedy about generally speaking, non-comic subject, that is, cannibalism. This film comes from 1971 and is in beautiful color, filmed in the Amazon or along the coast, more accurately, of Brazil. We'll be talking about the film, its cultural reference, and its peculiar form of comedy afterwards with two guests. Today we have Professor Ella Shohat of the College of Staten Island of the City University of New York and Professor Gene Franco of Columbia University. Enjoy How Tasty Was My Little Frenchman? Hi, welcome back to Cinema Then, Cinema Now. I hope you had a feast of a film with How Tasty Was My Little Frenchman. If you'll forgive me for that pun and stick around, I think we have some interesting things to say in the next 30 minutes or so. Before we begin with that, let me introduce to you today's two guests. Sitting to my left is my colleague, Ella Shohat, who's a professor of cinema studies at the College of Staten Island of the City University of New York. Ella is a specialist on third world cinema and is the author of the recently published The Israeli Cinema, East, West, and the Politics of Representation from the University of Texas, Press. She's currently, her scholarship currently leads her into questions of gender, race, and of colonialist discourse. Sitting to my right is Professor Gene Franco. Gene is a professor of comparative literature at Columbia University. Her most recent book is Plotting Women, Gender and Representation in Mexico. In addition to her literary courses, she has taught a number of courses on film at Columbia, including seminars on Buñuel and Latin American film. She is, in fact, also the president-elect of the Latin American Studies Association of America. Gene, let's start, if we might, with some of the literary origins of this film itself. This film comes from a whole tradition of narratives, captivity narratives. What kind of relationship does this film have? What is its origin in any particular narrative, and what kind of relationship does it have to that tradition?
Well, it's related to one very specific captivity narrative of a German called Hans Staden, who in the 1540s was shipwrecked off the coast of Brazil and was captured by Tupinambá, and in 1557, which is the year, which ostensibly is the year of the film, it's dated 1557, he published his account of his stay among the cannibal tribes. One of the big differences, of course, in his account and the account of the film is that he wasn't eaten.
Right, and he lived to write the book.
Right, he lived to write the book. And the other big difference, of course, is he never admits to having a woman in the film.
Okay.
So there are two big differences. But the opening credits, the engravings that are shown in the opening credits, and which are intermingled with shots of the Frenchman, right, do in fact come from this particular,
from
Staden's book. And of course, one of the other differences being that he's not French, he's German, but I think there are some interesting reasons that maybe we can discuss why Nelson Pereira would choose a Frenchman to be eaten rather than a German.
Oh, okay. Okay. But
actually, he's played by a Brazilian Italian.
Right. Oh, is that right?
Right.
he passed as the phrase. Right. As the phrase goes.
I think it's an interesting point because on the filmmaker's part, because it's a choice that reflects the European colonizer as yes. one of and the same, whether he's French, German, or Italian, mm-hmm. in terms of the Native American perspective, which the film attempt to present. It's kind of an interesting point to collapse the different mm-hmm. European powers into a one interest group. Mm-hmm. When yeah. it's viewed from a Latin American or Amerindian perspective.
Yeah, now that's one of the interesting things about about this film is this question of perspective. Mm-hmm. In right. the opening sequence of the film, which moves very, very rapidly in this pre-credit sequence, sets us up for, I think, the criticism of colonialism we're going to see in the rest of the film.
Right. I think what's interesting about it, if we compare it to the different colonial narratives, which always focus on the perspective of the colonizers. They
right.
come from the ocean. Here the camera is set on land, so actually you see the perspective you get to see, an abstract perspective of the Native Americans or the inhabitants of that land. Even the language, the discoverer, is usually a language which means certain perspective, certain focalization, and here it's subverted simply by having the camera set on land and not on the ocean.
Right, right. So we don't really see a shipwreck. We begin after they've arrived. Yeah,
right.
And there's also, I think, another point to be made about that is the very interesting way in which the engraving, the quotations are all from very well-known accounts of Brazil written by discoverers, missionaries, but always written from the point of view of the colonizer.
Right.
And from time to time, the narrative is interrupted, the film narrative is interrupted by one of these little quotations,
right.
which tell you that Indians are beasts, they're animals, they're
right.
guilty of every possible sin, right? And then the image shows you the Indians, dancing or whatever, feasting and so on.
Right.
And then there's the difference between the language, the dialogue, and the image,
right.
which
yeah.
comes up again and again, like when the Puritan, he's French, by the way, because the French were fighting the Portuguese for possession
and
of Brazil.
And if he's French Protestant.
And it's French Protestant, right.
right.
It was French Protestant. So that's important to bear in mind, because there's the hypocrisy of the Calvinists who say that he was trying to escape and knocked him on the head and he falls in the water. So again and again you get those little slippages between the dialogue and the image.
Right. Actually, you see it actually already in the pre-credit sequence, and you can see the pre-credit sequence as a kind of an anticipation of what kind of strategy the narrative is going to employ throughout the film, which is a strategy of, as you said, contradiction between
right.
the official history, mm-hmm. which is inscribed by those intertitles, mm-hmm. and the narrative itself, which is actually the perspective of the film, an anti-colonial perspective. And already in this pre-credit sequence, what we see is this official account of the Native Americans as barbarians, savages. And what we see in terms on the image track, we actually see exactly the opposite. We see them as
yes.
hospitable people,
yeah.
very generous people, mm-hmm. who are very nice, very mm-hmm. welcoming mm-hmm. toward the French or the colonizers. Mm-hmm. They even offer them women. And actually, it's very interesting. As we see them hugging the mm-hmm. Native American women, we hear it's told. I mean, it's seen exactly at
right.
the same point that mm-hmm. we hear them speaking about the fact that they have no human face. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting, this question mm-hmm. of body as they're touching them, mm-hmm. but actually saying, so it tells you about them using their sexuality mm-hmm. And yet at the same time not recognizing their humanity, which is quite ironic mm-hmm. Representation.
Mm-hmm. Well, that there's an interesting, I think, point about this difference between the pre-credit sequence mm-hmm. and the body of the text. So the pre-credit mm-hmm. sequence sets up this contrast between the image and then the voice over the official
right.
colonialist account. But then when we're in the film itself, one of the things I find peculiar about it is that we're following the experiences of the Frenchman, who would be the person that the European would identify with, or the North American. Yet somehow the film is from the perspective, to use that sort of phrase, of the people themselves.
I think it's interesting that the perspective cannot be limited to question of points of view. I think that's what we have to distinguish. It's not a traditional Hollywood film where sympathy and identification of the spectator is constructed through the simple point of view shots.
Right.
Here, it's a much more abstract kind of perspective of the Native American. It's not simply sympathy for a particular character. It's channeled through a general perspective, anti-colonial perspective, and it doesn't mean that the film would idealize the Native Americans as this kind of paradise, which is again the whole question of the discovered land as a form of paradise is typical of colonial discourse. So the film doesn't take also the notion of positive image of the discover land, neither a negative,
by the noble savages. It's not, they're not noble savages either.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, what interests me very much is like the way the film blurs that boundary. Having set up the boundary, those are the evil savages and we're the good Christians, then it proceeds to blur that distinction, because the Frenchman kills Portuguese and whoops with joy as he kills them, right? And then he's quite obviously very interested in money, and you know, he does everything, he engages in all kinds of deception to escape. So there's a blurring of the boundaries between who are the savages and who are the civilized.
I was just going to further that point, or the fact that even within the same camp, I mean, even within the European camp, there's the whole issue of, is he French or is he Portuguese?
Right.
And then after we understand he's French, well, his own side finds it very convenient. This is, well, it would be difficult to convince them of this.
Right.
So why don't you stick around here? I'll work with you. And so the situation becomes very complicated, and a division like nationality.
Yes, it doesn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. And going back to something that Alan said, which I think is very interesting, is the scene in which the woman describes their culture hero, begins to describe how he came and taught them to plant corn, and then the Frenchman's voice takes over with him imaged as the culture hero. And I think that's one point where maybe the perspective becomes very ironic, right? Because
I think it exactly continues this same ideas we were talking before, because the narrative actually begins with her telling it in 2P.
Yes.
And then the voiceover shifts to him speaking French. When he describes the typical colonial discourse, basically what he does, he appropriates their story about kind of a Promethean story about a god bringing knowledge into the tribe. And he takes it over. And what basically happening in terms of the narrative, that he appropriates that myth into a colonial myth, which is the Promethean myth of the European bringing light and knowledge and rescuing the colonial land from from the natives. And, and I mean, actually, the classical apologia for colonial appropriation of land was the fact that the colonized people were ignorant, and therefore the European had to rescue them and bring them knowledge. And that's exactly what happens in on the image track in terms of, and the soundtrack, the point that it shifts into French. And also there is a typical narration actually of the colonizer describing themselves as perceived as gods by the Native Americans.
Like Cortez, for instance,
exactly. And what the film does at the end, once again, it shifts perspective at the end of this myth. Once again, she ends the story. She began the story and she ends this story. And once again, it moves into 2P. And she tells the story of the rebellion. So the film doesn't end with the narration of the French. It ends with her rebellion.
Yes.
And it's interesting in terms of gender colonial, the intersection of gender and colonial discourses, because ultimately it's the woman, it's her story and not his story that ultimately wins. Mm-hmm. And that's why when we spoke about perspective in the film, mm-hmm. we can say that it is the colonized and the woman perspective which wins at mm-hmm. the end, and not the European male perspective.
I'm not sure about that.
Okay.
I may have a discrepancy there, because I think it's true that, well, of course, she wounds him and prevents him from escaping, and then
eats him.
But that's not the last shot. I mean, the last shot's an empty shore, and a quotation from Mem de Sá, who was the governor of Brazil, saying that we left no savages alive on this shore. Mm-hmm. So what delights me about this film is precisely this, that the viewer is kept uncertain all the way through. I mean, you can never sort of plant yourself in some comfortable perspective and say...
Maybe emotionally, in terms of emotional identification.
Yes. But then it's true that they have the triumph of, you know, eating this Frenchman. But on the other hand, immediately afterwards, it's assumed that they will be wiped out, or, you know, this Indian tribe is going to disappear. So there's a tremendous irony about that. And part of the way it disappears is because they try and get gunpowder from... from the Portuguese, so there's all this transaction with the gunpowder. Mm-hmm. And, of course, Hans Staden was a gunner, and the Frenchman is a gunner. And one of the reasons that he's kept alive part of the time is so that they can get the technology from the white man. It's not just eating the white man to get his strength, but also gaining his...
Strength as a symbol of technology.
It's very interesting to me, though, that this twist at the end is one of these perspectival shifts. The perspective is a very slippery word, mm-hmm. because it takes mm-hmm. us from one time scheme to another time scheme. Makes us contextualize this very interesting story that has psychological identification mm-hmm. in it.
And anthropological.
Absolutely, and put it in this much larger scheme of matters, historically, economically, mm-hmm. in terms of power relations, all of that kind of stuff.
Well, it leads you to ask, why should the Europeans have survived and not the indigenous? I mean, I think probably that's one of the impacts that it has, here are these, we're the survivors in a way, right? We're the survivors, and this race, who you can't judge morally as better or worse or anything, because the film keeps you, I think...
I think the film is not about moral issues.
It's not about moral issues or power relations. Yeah. But the fact of the matter is that they are wiped out at the end of the film. So, I mean, you know, the viewer then asks, well, are we the survivors? And then in what relation do we have to this... genocide, presumably.
Yes, absolutely.
Despite the fact that in that particular narrative, the Native American appropriator ate mm-hmm. the European, it's they who are going to be massacred. And there is tremendous disproportion between the genocide of millions of people versus the cannibalism of one person. Mm-hmm. I mean, if we were to assume that there was ever cannibalism, as we know, I'm sure probably you refer to it in the discussion of Makunaima, that cannibalism is not, I mean, there are no actual historical testimony for the existence of cannibalism.
But what it is it becomes a cultural metaphor for those put in mm-hmm. a position of certain kinds of power relations, and it becomes a model for dealing and explaining those power relations.
Particularly as it was used in the Brazilian context of the late 60s, appropriating this metaphor from the modernist movement of the
20s. Who appropriated from Hans Staden, because Osvaldo Andrade, who initiated the Movimento Antropofagi, knew about this particular text. So, you know, there's a very beautiful linkage here.
Right. This is a cannibalizing of texts.
I mean, that's what Osvaldo Andrade, basically, one of his contentions.
The cannibalistic manifesto.
Yeah, that the relationship of the periphery to the metropolis should be one of cannibalization. Yeah. Right. We are going to eat them, and we are going to acquire their power, and the center of culture power is going to shift to the periphery.
Yeah.
And so
that was against the purist idea of not having anything to do with the metropolis.
Exactly.
And definitely you can see it in the history also of the Brazilian Cinema Novo in terms of changing, and actually you can see it really in the history of Dos Santos himself, beginning in the mid-50s, making a film called Rio 40 Degrees, which was a kind of a neorealist film, and moving into a film called Vidas Secas, Barren Lives, which actually, it's interesting because it was the first phase of Cinema Novo was also called, was part of this aesthetic of hunger.
Right.
So actually you constantly deal with metaphors of the food. Either you're hungry or you end up being cannibalistic, you know, because you cannot actually afford, once you're on the margins, afford to be, you have to choose almost a question of either or, because aesthetic of hunger, the first phase of Cinema Novo, which you see very well in the early work of Dos Santos, is a completely different style of filmmaking in terms of methods of production, low budget, in terms of style of shooting, which is very harsh, short in the northeast of Brazil.
Yes.
And the theme of it, not only the style and the methods of production, but the themes are about people literally going hungry. And then at the end of the 60s, there is a movement, the tropicalist movement, which Dos Santos, already shifted his kind of, his style of filmmaking, his methods of production into more, you can see it even shift into color, whereas the early Cinema Novo films were black and white, the later films like Macunaíma and How Testy, My Frenchman. By the way, it's in the Brazilian, in Portuguese, it's How Testy Was My Frenchman.
Right.
The little is a
they
bit.
The bigger the better.
The bigger the better, right. So there is this, evolution in terms of the strategy of filmmaking and in terms of the cultural thinking that was happening in Brazil, and you can see it actually in the evolution of the work of Dos Santos himself.
Now, this is very interesting to me in terms of the responses of various national cinemas to the dominant style of Hollywood filmmaking. Now, there's one of the, there are a couple of positions, but what's really interesting to me is this is not this does not come out of two of the more obvious positions. I mean, one of them, which is, we've already, you talked about a little bit, is Cinema Novo sees a lot of its origins in neorealism, showing the social and economic conditions as they are, and doing so not with the same kinds of strong plotting, et cetera, that Hollywood has, but also it means showing suffering, and it means that there we may have to see things that are displeasurable in a certain kind of way. Now the second thing is that there has been in a number of avant-garde traditions of filmmaking a anti-pleasure aesthetic that says, you know, that we must break all the codes of pleasure that Hollywood has set up, but somehow that must give us codes of displeasure. That's the only way to confront this. But this is neither of those at all.
That's
very interesting because
I think you're right to point it out, because you can see in the evolution of Cinema Novo and Dos Santos' work, you see that the early films exactly are this kind of idea of displeasure. We leave a situation, and actually Glauber Rocha in his Manifesto of Hunger speaks about this idea that we leave a situation of displeasure would be a euphemism, of hunger, of violence, of oppression. There is no reason why we should adopt a Hollywoodian model of aesthetics. We should adopt an aesthetic that is appropriate to our reality. An aesthetic of hunger is the one which is appropriate to our reality. But at the same time, the intellectuals and the filmmakers have realized that they cannot actually communicate with the very people that the film talk about, and in the third phase of Cinema Novo, in the tropicalist phase, there is an attempt also to create a truly popular cinema, not only cinema that would touch on popular theme in terms of the themes that belong to the people, but rather will be also commercial, that people will come and see them. Popular in box office, popular in theme, and popular in terms of representing the
but
people.
But how does that relate to the military government? Because the other aspect of tropicalismo was that it comes when the military government was in power. This film is 1970, 1969, 1970 were years of intense repression in Brazil.
Yeah, right, yeah.
Obviously, it's interesting that Mukunaima and this film date from that particularly repressive period and show societies in which repression is either non-existent or in which, you know, there's some sort
of... Yes and no. I mean, I think we can read these films, of course, allegorically.
Yes.
As, you know, in the case of How Tasty, obviously it's set in the past, but at the same time, it could be read to a certain extent as a essay about the present-day Brazil. First of all, I think there is maybe a direct reference to that quite early in the film when the Frenchman is met to drone, right?
Yes, when he's sort of thrown in the
thrown
water,
into
whether
the water.
Say he was trying
right.
to escape, which is what happened to a lot of prisoners in Latin America from one time to the other.
Right, and in Mukunaima you actually see also direct references to that in terms of the character of C, the gorilla,
right. mm-hmm.
who actually fights in the city,
mm-hmm.
and or the repression when they run in the city, they escape the police, or they give speeches, and the police is after them. So there are constant references, although they are indirect and relatively subtle, because censorship was very strong during this period. So I feel like the question of allegory becomes a way of avoiding dealing directly with repression because of censorship.
But don't you also see the, that, for instance, the idea of sexual pleasure in the film, the bodily, the pleasure of the body, I mean, the body that's absolutely without clothes, which is sort of free to be without clothes.
Right.
I mean, I sort of think of 1970 and wonder, have other films in which there's so much, in which nudity is taken so for granted, for instance, as in this particular film.
Right.
And there's obviously, I mean, you're talking about pleasure, but as opposed to Vidas Secas. I mean, here's a film where there's obviously the pleasurable of the body,
the
view.
But that also brings up a lot of film scholarly work that's been done on the gaze and the look and how Hollywood film in particular positions the gaze and therefore, I mean, ideologically positions the spectator to look. And one of the things that I find so pleasurable about is that this film does not
do that.
Exactly.
No, it
I think it subverts this whole question of gaze because you see people walking naked and without any moralistic judgment. In fact, it's treated very naturally.
Kind of scopic or voyeuristic idea. I mean, you know.
Right. Yeah. And there is no distinction between male nudity. And in that sense, it's pretty egalitarian in terms of its representation of nudity. It doesn't simply capitalize it the kind of a pornographic image, even though it has the pleasure of nudity. But it has a distant look. Usually you have kind of long shot, which is very different from the way Hollywood would frame parts of the body. I mean, the way Hollywood can frame not just a simple leg or hand would be much more erotic in a sense.
Yeah, and they're doing work with their bodies. I mean, that's the other thing. They're naked and they're doing things like carrying things or planting or in a boat or whatever. I mean, they're not. It's not just the erotic body. It's
the body. It's the body that works.
Well,
and actually, the actors and actresses, the film was filmed during 3 months in Paraty, and where they constructed
a
Tupinamba village. And what's interesting about it that the actors and actresses were wearing nothing during the 3 months of the shootings. So they actually reproduce in terms of the way they shot the film, the very lives that they were portraying in the film.
It's interesting that they would be there so long in doing this because obviously there's a double shedding process. I mean, there's literally the shedding of one's clothing, but it's also the shedding of all the assumptions that go along with that, both from particular causes of societies, but also from film itself.
The
notion of you're doing a nude scene. There's a famous instance in the French film, Le Jeu s'élève, which is one of the first films, a very, very distinguished film. The actress Arletty was to have a very brief nude scene, and of course it had to be handled with everyone leaving the set, with contractual obligations about this and that, you know, no photographers on the set, et cetera.
Right.
And, you know, what do you do here when you've got an entire village? And
Yeah, I think it's interesting what Jean mentioned before also about the fact that the film is made during the late 60s yes. And 70s in terms of, also it's a period, I think, generally of cultural revolution, not only in Brazil, but generally throughout the world. And I think there's a general tendency during that period because of the questioning of capitalist society, there is a general attempt either toward nostalgia, in this case it's not simply nostalgia, but an attempt to look for the roots, other kind of roots for civilizations. Mm. And the question of nudity becomes very important just because it symbolizes alternative cultures, cultures which are not mainstream. And maybe you can see the film also as a counterculture.
Well, also it begins with the Puritans.
Right, well, this is a very important point.
Which is very interesting. It begins with the Puritans and ends, you know, with the girl eating the little neck, which is
there's
also a subtext in the film. Isn't she getting revenge for her dead husband?
Right.
Right. But she can have pleasure and have revenge at the same time, which is the two things. So there's this revenge, but without a certain kind of anger. Mm. Well, I'll have this pleasure. I'll instruct you in this, and then I'll have your little neck, and so then I will have had pleasure and revenge my husband, and that works out better
and
for me.
My community, even. Yes. Yeah. Just my husband, because actually what's interesting about the film that you see them collectively mourning about the death of their dad.
And that wonderful scene at the end where they rehearse rehearse his death, and she teaches him what he has to say at particular moments, and then he wants to escape from the ritual at a certain moment. He pushes her back when she prompts him, and then he acts real. I mean, you know, there's a difference.
Yes, yes.
He's not acting the ritual. He's saying those words. I am here. My friends will avenge me.
And they actually do,
you know. I mean, it's a very remarkable scene, that, I think.
Well, I don't know if it's revenge on the two of you for this interesting discussion, but we have to end our discussion now because we're really out of time on this. If you'd like more information about this series, or about cinema studies, graduate or undergraduate, drop us a line. Drop it to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the College of Staten Island, Staten Island, New York, 10301. Let me give you that information again, okay? Drop it to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the College of Staten Island, New York, 10301. Well, Ella? Thank you for bringing your anti-colonialist perspective. Jean, for your perspective, anti-colonialist, and well-informed about all these matters. I hope that our discussion here leads you to thought and discussion at home that you enjoy. Thanks for joining us. We'll be right back.